Roski.
Hello, great day.
It is time for Roski on Politics this morning.
Today, I thought we'd talk a little bit about money in politics. It's always fascinating.
Oh, is there a correlation there?
Is there a correlation?
I don't know, yeah.
You know, Terry McAuliffe is now the governor of Virginia. He was in my little program, Chasing the Hill, and he made an interesting point back then. He goes, yes, money in politics isn't necessarily a good thing, but it does show, if you have a lot of different donors, it shows a breadth of support.
Yeah.
So let's talk about Bernie Sanders real quick. As we know, he did very well in New Hampshire, 22% victory, 50,000 votes ahead of Hillary Clinton, which was a bigger win than even the people who thought he'd win was going to get. But here's what I thought was fascinating. The first 21 hours after he won, remember in his speech he said, we're going to have a fundraiser right here. And the next 21 hours, they raised $5.6 million.
Did they really?
In 21 hours. In 1 minute. That night, his campaign announced that during 1 minute, they took 2,689 donations in 1 minute.
And these are all small donations.
Averaging $34 a piece.
Oh.
Now it's $34. They kicked it up a little bit.
They're $7. They bumped it.
So now since Tuesday, since he won in Tuesday, we're now on Thursday, they have raised $7.1 million. Averaging $34 a piece. Now here's the challenge. His opponent, Hillary Clinton, most of her donations have been large contributions, which have maxed out. $2,700 is the individual limit to give directly to a campaign. Of course, you can donate to what's called a super PAC, and you can do that unlimited. But if you really want to help a candidate, you really want to donate directly to the person. Rick Perry had this problem. His super PAC that was working on his behalf had over $6 million on hand, but Rick Perry campaign couldn't make their payroll. So you always want to, if you viewer want to help out a campaign, donate directly to the campaign. But anyway, Sanders has now actually broken Obama's most donations as of the end of this year. Now, this hasn't been updated since just this week, but Sanders, when 2015 was ended, he had 2.5 million separate donations. Hmm. Barack Obama had the previous record in 2011 with 2.2 million, and so now we can only imagine.
Is it as simple to say that the campaign money helps, obviously, the nuts and bolts of a campaign, mm-hmm. and that super PAC money buys advertising? Is that pretty much it?
It's both. But, you know, the term is you don't quit running for president, you run out of money. Is what happens. You know, John Kasich, his run here in Iowa, now this was November, he had only spent $5,000 here, but then the ads, because he didn't do much on air. So anyway, that's one way to say it. We got some videos to show. We're talking about Sanders.
Speaking of on air.
You guys seen the Hunger Games movie?
Right.
PETA was in town. Josh Hutcherson. We chatted with him about Sanders. Let's take a look.
Thoughts on the results?
I just think it's really exciting. You know, it's 8 months ago, he was 41 points behind Hillary. I mean, to come out with a virtual tie, like 50%, half the delegates, I just think it's a huge win. You know, and I think there's a lot of momentum coming out of this going into New Hampshire. I think they're going to do really well in New Hampshire. And, you know, I think it's the start of a really successful campaign.
And finally, you folks, you just did it. You were at the front line of the Iowa caucuses. What are your thoughts on what just happened here?
I mean, I think we said it. I think it was just something that people said couldn't be done. It was incredible, the fact that 8 months ago he was 50 points down. A month ago they said it was impossible, that there wasn't even a race at all. Not one Republican candidate had the words Bernie Sanders come out of their mouth. And I think it's cool now because he's gonna get that media attention and people are going to get to know him. And this is a trampoline. And the thing is, what I found is that if people just learn about Bernie, they believe in him and they understand his message, and it's clear and it's simple and it makes sense for this time. So I think now this is a great place to bounce off of and get him out there even more for people.
What'd you think of the caucus process?
It was so cool to be able to be here on the ground floor and see how it all works. I didn't really know exactly how a caucus was run.
I still don't exactly.
I still have some major questions,
coin tosses.
I guess in Vegas, because in Nevada they have a caucus there as well, and there they do high card. If it comes down to a tie,
they
pick high card.
Really?
How
appropriate. That's amazing.
Yeah. So yeah, it's pretty wild, but you know, it's a really cool thing to be a part of. I mean, Iowa takes great pride in having a caucus, being the first state, you know, and to be able to be here, also just in the history of the U.S., to be able to be here on the ground floor and see how they do it. Yeah. This kind of ancient practice of American history, especially the Democrats standing on one side of the room and you know, be like, go stand in your corner. That's with who, for who you support. You know, it's really pretty cool. Yeah.
So that was actually the day after the caucus, as we filmed at the airport. And Lou, I love your idea. Instead of high card or coin toss, what do we do?
Cornhole. You have the board.
Closest.
You have board and you have two holes in it, and you keep throwing the bat until one goes in somebody's hole.
I think it's a great idea. Okay. So real quick here, one of the campaigns, I'm pretty excited about this. Ms. Schmillen was there. One of the unicorn candidates on the Republican side is Jim Gilmore.
We were there,
and I said, there's Jim Gilmore, we got to get him. So one of the, I want to say, and I'm just going to say it, possibly the only Iowa interview this man has ever done. Here is me chatting with presidential candidate Jim Gilmore.
How was the debate tonight for you, sir?
Well, I think it went well because I had the opportunity to get my message out. I made it very, very clear that I thought this whole process had been manipulated, but much more importantly, I was able to talk about the key issues, this international crisis that we're facing with this international Islamic terrorist organizations, with the challenges we're seeing from Russia, China, North Korea, Iran. I was able to point out that I am the only one who have the real credentials to deal with that. And then second, I was able to talk about the fact that I'm the only veteran in the race, and I care about these veterans' issues. And third, I'm the only candidate that's a board member of the National Rifle Association, and I feel, on behalf of Second Amendment rights, really to the bottom of my heart. So I was able to get those ideas out.
I believe you mentioned in your debate that Trump's event for veterans, you were not going to attend, and you had some pretty strong feelings about that.
Well, I did, because I think that if you're going to be president of the United States, you don't go over to another person's event that is in conflict with the debate process. I think that he should be coming to the debate. I suspect maybe he will.
How have you enjoyed participating in the Iowa caucus process? What do you think of Iowans, sir?
Well, I love Iowa, and I campaigned in Iowa in 2008 quite substantially, and I made the decision strategically because of financial reasons that I had to put my resources into New Hampshire. So I don't expect a show in Iowa, but I appreciate the opportunity to be here and part of this forum tonight in Iowa.
So you've definitely been focused on New Hampshire. How are your efforts turning out there, sir?
I think we're making progress there. We're making a lot of progress. We're now, just for the first time, really beginning to reach out to a large number of people in New Hampshire. But look, the Iowa process is very vital. If I had had $5 million, I would have participated in both. But having the force to make a choice, we chose New Hampshire, but it doesn't reduce my admiration for the people of Iowa.
Senator Santorum mentioned during your debate that had this process with two debates been going on during his cycle last time, he wouldn't have won the Iowa caucuses. What do you think about there being two debate stages?
I think that the format has been awful.
Oh, okay.
Are you talking about the
undercard and main event?
I think it's awful.
Okay.
I think it's awful. It's gross and unfair, and here's why.
Okay.
The people who get on the stage get poll numbers. The people who get poll numbers get on the stage. So it's circular, and that's unfair, and it's wrong, and it subjects the whole process of the nomination of the president to the manipulation of the establishment press. So it's wrong. It would have been easily resolved. All you had to do is take the 12 candidates and then draw lots and do two different forums, if you chose to, six each, and it would have been fine. But instead, the press chose the candidates that they wanted the most. They set the standards that way, and it's very unfair, and it's bad for the people of the United States.
If you were to reach the Oval Office, what would be your key issue?
My key issue would be the international crisis that we're facing today. My first thing, I would call the Prime Minister of Canada and then the Prime Minister of Great Britain and make sure that our allies understood they had a friend in the White House. And then second of all, I would deal with the veterans issues. I'm the only veteran in this race. And third, I would deal with this culture that the president is setting up to try to remove guns from the American people, because I think that it ill-defines the individuality of the American people. The law and the Constitution trust the people of the United States under the Second Amendment to have firearm rights. To try to remove that diminishes the rights and quality of citizenship of the people of the United States.
So that was presidential candidate Jim Gilmore, former governor of Virginia. Sunday's show is co-hosted by the lovely J. Ann Selzer of Selzer Polling.
Ah.
So she's co-hosting with me on Sunday. You'll see John Kasich. You'll see more of Jim Gilmore, Jeff Kaufman with the GOP here in Iowa, and a bunch of other stuff Sunday morning.
How about that? Sounds good. Be good, man. Have a safe trip. He's going to Washington, D.C. right now.
Next Sunday, my show's from D.C. The week after that will be from Nevada, from the Nevada caucuses.
All right. Woo.